Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this little kind of informational or tutorial on energy storage and energy density. Now, I've been kind of talking for quite a while about doing this because energy density in particular is something I'm interested in terms of the future of something like solar power. So if I want to store the energy that I'm getting from my solar panels in something like a bank of batteries, I want to know how efficient and how much energy I can get into and store in those batteries. It becomes quite an interesting science because let's say, for instance, you've got an RC helicopter, a remote control helicopter. And one of the important things there is obviously you need an energy source to run it, but you want that energy source to be lightweight. And that's where in particular, understanding energy density can be important. I mean, if I show you these three pin light batteries that I've got, or these three AA batteries. They are all rated for 1.5 volts, and they may, in some cases, show you a rating in, let's say, milliamp hour. But milliamps or amp hours often don't paint the whole picture because they're not taking voltage into account. So that's where understanding something in watt hours is far more valuable. But then ultimately translating those watt hours to the actual weight or mass. Because believe it or not, let's say something like this lithium battery for its mass contains a lot of energy. So that's what we want to take a closer look at. And once you have that energy density, you can then make direct comparisons with, let's say, something like the supercapacitor or a lead acid battery. Let's just have a look at some quick theory before we have a practical example of how we test or how we can measure and test for energy density. Right, so let's get down to some theory, and then I'll get to showing you a practical example of how I actually use a certain electronic DC load to measure the capacity of a battery. We're also going to have a look at a spreadsheet and database of all the data I've collected to date. There's some very interesting facts that do come out of it because it doesn't just come down to energy density. It's the way your energy source can deliver that energy. Right, so the first question then is obviously, what is energy density? And to understand that, or to get to that, what we want to know is, what is energy? And ultimately, because energy is power over time, okay, which is the watt hour, what is power? Now, power is the ability to do some work. And in electricity, obviously, power drives appliances or devices. So to do that, we need voltage and current. And voltage times current is power, or watts. So if we use watts over time, that's where we get watt hours. Now, I've got another tutorial that talks about power and energy, and I'll annotate that or have a link below if you do want to go into the more specifics about that. So what we're doing, so when it comes down to density, ultimately what we're doing is once we understand what the watt hours inside an energy source, we weigh it. We find out what its weight is, and then we can actually find out the kind of energy for the weight. And then we come down to a standard unit so that we can actually do direct comparisons between different energy storage types. Now, before we move on, there are other interesting things related to energy, and that is, we're talking about density, but another thing you could be interested in is size or volume. You could want to know, rather than just the mass of your energy storage device, is the actual volume that it takes up. Now, that's something I'm not covering here, but I'm just pointing out, if you go and kind of measure the volume of all your energy storage devices, you can then work out your energy per volume as opposed to per weight. Then also power. This is energy, but you may be more interested in the power that can be delivered. You know, I'm thinking of, I want, let's say, 5 watts over an hour, where you want 50 watts to drive something. And now you can work out power density as well. But again, that's another topic. Now, just as a little example, if we look over here, let's say we've got a 12 volt sealed lead acid battery. And that happens to be rated for 18 amp hour. Now, something I want to highlight, and I always mention about the ratings of batteries in particular. A battery manufacturer will give a rating on a battery, and that rating happens under a certain load and under certain temperature conditions. So that you need to be wary of first. But often, you will only get that 18 amp hour once you hit like 11 volts or 10.5 volts at your battery. And at that point in time, you're already causing damage to your battery. So that's why I say what you need to do, if you are looking at the amp hour rating of a battery, is realistically only take out about half of that or less to be conserving the life of your battery. But that's the problem with that kind of rating. So obviously that's why I asked the question at what voltage, because that can vary between batteries. And that's why, and they are quoting that at a nominal 12 volts. They're not taking voltage into account. Whereas watt hours do take voltage into account. So it's far more comprehensive. So if we have a look at this example, in my spreadsheet that we'll have a look at, I've already calculated that that battery at a certain load, and I discharged that battery, I think about 4 amps, delivered 158 watt hours, and it was at 5.2 kilograms. Now I wanna say at, so it weighed 5.2 kilograms. So that's the important factor. So once you've got its weight, you can simply divide the watt hours by the weight, and you then come down to an energy density of 30.39 watt hours per kilogram. So that's what we're trying to get to, is the watt hours per kilogram. I've got the supercapacitor, which has got a stated capacity of 2,600 farad. That, in my testing, tested at 500 milliamps, and this is where it's important. If you want to do direct comparisons, you obviously need for your energy source to be discharged under the similar conditions, i.e. temperature and also the load. So that delivered 2.1 watt hour. It weighed just over half a kilogram. So that equated to 3.74 watt hour per kilogram. So immediately, well, I haven't gone and discharged the lead acid battery at the same discharge rate, but nonetheless, you can see there's quite a large disparity between 3.7 and 30 watt hour per kilogram. So you can soon see that that's why lead acid batteries are so popular and why supercapacitors at the moment aren't near the energy density to hold as much energy as something like a lead acid battery. Now, if we go further and have a look at this 1.5 volt lithium battery that I've tested, this at the moment happens to be the kind of ultimate energy source that I've gone and tested amongst all the other ones. It has got 3.8 watt hour. It only weighs 15 grams, so 0.015 kilogram. And that equates to 258.6 watt hour per kilogram. So once you start comparing like for like, and as long as you've got similar discharge rates, so you can do direct comparisons, you can then soon see what energy source could be really handy for your next project. There are other criteria you need to take into account. As I said, when we get to the spreadsheet now, for instance, if we go and have a look at the discharge curve of a battery versus a capacitor, you'll note that if we've got this axis up here, which is voltage, and that's done over time, a battery's voltage initially when you apply the load will initially drop a little bit, but then it stays reasonably constant, slowly, slowly dropping, and then it hits the kind of what I call the cliff, when it drops off and kind of goes to nothing, if you're going to be discharging it that far, which is what I do for my tests. Whereas a capacitor starts dropping and just almost has a linear downslope going down, and the voltage goes down. Now the battery, of course, you want your device to operate, needs to operate at a certain voltage, and that's where batteries are really great. But for a supercapacitor, that isn't really handy for operating something at a constant voltage. So to make a supercapacitor useful, you need to put it into a DC to DC converter, which is going to give you a constant voltage out on the other side. There are downsides to that, obviously. There are losses in the DC to DC converter. Also, as the voltage drops on the capacitor, for it to maintain the constant voltage out, it needs to increase the current. So you're going to have a progressively increasing current, which could be, obviously, you need to cater for that in the DC to DC converter. It needs to handle the power and obviously the current going out through the actual cables themselves. Let's go and have a quick look at my spreadsheet so I can compare the devices I've looked at so far. Right, so if we have a look at the spreadsheet, you can see in column A here, I've got the energy sources labeled, and what I've done, I've sorted them. If you have a look at column G, I've sorted them by their watt hour per kilogram, so the energy density. So the best energy density is at the top and they kind of go down. Now just note that obviously I have also noted here the load. So at the first one over here is 100 milliamp, and you can obviously see if you have a heavier load, then your energy density is going to be less because you're pulling more current. What I've tried to do with things like the AA batteries is I've done two. I've done one at 100 milliamp and one at 500 milliamp. If you're scientifically doing this for yourself because you've got a project, well then what you want to do is obviously choose your load specifically so that you can understand your energy density. But this certainly should give you some idea, it gives you a bit of a range. As we get to some of the other items, like for instance, I went and tested some LiPos, and I'm going to be doing more of that testing soon. There's obviously various different types of the Duracell batteries. I've got the lead crystal battery here. I've got a standard lead acid battery, and if we go and have a look at their results, you can obviously see the load, and you can go and see the different energy densities over here. We then get down to the kind of super and hybrid capacitors. Some of them I was linking up in series and in parallel to do my own little tests. So I've got all that information in the spreadsheet. And as you can see, at the moment, currently in terms of the best energy density are those Energizer lithium, ultimate lithium batteries. Now then, to what we should need to also go and have a look at is the actual curves. So in these spreadsheets, you can go to the tabs at the bottom here, and the raw data from the actual manure or whatever DC load I was doing is noted over here. So I've gone to the best of my ability now, I've gone and put in formulas to work out the watt hours, the amp hours, watt hours, I've got the weight, and then I've got the kind of energy to weight. And I've also gone and graphed that. Now what I've also done in column M here, I've got something called energy rate of change. And I've got that because what happens obviously is ultimately when you start getting to the end of the life, getting to the low voltages where your energy is almost depleted, it can go on for a very long time. So I kind of wanted to put a mark in the sand where I stopped the test at a similar rate of change, because otherwise, for instance, your amp hours continues to clock up even though you're not pulling out much energy. So if we go down, you can see the rate of energy is at 0.002. And we get to a point where it gets to about zero, and that's where I set my marker, and I took the, that's what I noted in the end results. But if you happen to have a look at the amp hours here, you'll see the amp hours continue to clock up, okay, because it's still drawing a minute amount of milliamps. So that clocks up, but basically your energy is depleted, and that's where your amp hours can be a little bit misleading. So that's the rate of change. Now, if we go back up to the top and have a look at the graph, what I've done here is I've gone and graphed over time. So as you can see over here, this is the voltage on the y-axis over time. So I'll just pull it down a bit. And you can see, as I said on here, you get a nice curve where it initially drops off and then the voltage steadily drops. And on here you can actually go and put a cursor and you can actually see at the point in time and see what the voltage is. It drops off steadily, 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 and then it kind of hits the cliff. So you might want to understand at what you can use this and in this data to actually go and understand the kind of energy density or the amount of energy at a certain voltage, because that might be particular to a certain type of project that you're using. There's the voltage discharge curve. These curves up here denote both watt hours and amp hours, and then the curves at the bottom here are showing power and current. So there's a fair amount of useful information, and if we go and have a look at, let's say, one of the capacitors, and we go and have a look at its graph, you can see the discharge curve is very different, and that's what I'm saying.
having the dates like this, where you not only have the energy density but also can see the profile of the discharge curve, can be critical in terms of understanding what energy source is best for your application. As you can see, the voltage just totally drops off on the capacitors, and that's where if you want to make a good use of the energy that's inside a capacitor for powering something, then you seriously need to consider using a DC to DC converter, but need to understand the ramifications of that. You've got losses and your current is going to climb as your voltage drops if you're trying to maintain a consistent voltage out.
Right, so let's look at the kind of target of the kind of next discharge or energy density experiment, and that's going to be this Duracell Quantum battery, which I've mentioned before in a video. Now, Duracell are claiming that this is the kind of world's longest lasting battery. They kind of note that it's underneath that it's a normal alkaline, but they don't say the world's longest lasting alkaline, which I think is a little bit misleading in their advertising. Now, so the big thing I want to show you on the scale, and I'm going to be measuring in grams. I've got the three batteries here, these two Duracells. So here's a standard Duracell. I'll put it on there. And as you can see, that comes in around 24 grams. Take that off. I put the Quantum on there. That's at 25. So it might have a very small weight difference. Now I've got the Energizer Ultimate Lithium here. And if we take that, 14 grams. It's a huge difference. I mean, just feeling it in your hand, it's very lightweight. I mean, it's pleasant if I have, for instance, my Fluke 287 now, because this thing chews through batteries and it runs off like six of these AA's. That's what I use inside my Fluke. For one, it actually makes it a fair bit lighter, and obviously the duration, at least I get out of it, is a lot longer than using standard alkaline batteries. So that's going to be our next test. We're going to go over to the Meinuo DC load and connect this up, and then we'll need to run it for a few hours. I'm going to test it at about 500 milliamps so we can get that test done fairly quickly, and then we'll see what the results are. Right, so I've got the DC load set up over here, and then I've got the wires coming down to a battery holder and the battery positioned over here. I'm saying battery obviously correctly. I should be calling it a cell, as it's just one cell. Now, what I'm using, although I've got some fairly thick wires that are coming to the actual battery holder itself, because there's the potential for some voltage drop across the leads, I've also got two sense wires. So these will pick up the voltage exactly at the cell itself to negate the voltage drop across the leads. Right, so this is the remote control software of the Meinuo DC load. Up here, it's got a battery kind of analysis tool where it'll discharge a battery and graph the amp hours. But from here, I can take the data and put it into that spreadsheet to get all the data I need. So I've already gone and preset up in the corner over here. I've gone and set it for half an amp. And then it's got a safe voltage down over here of 0.1. So you can specify if you don't discharge fully, particularly if you've got lithium batteries, you can specify where it's got a cutoff. It's also got a setting here to actually save the starting voltage. So as I noted, when you apply the load, the voltage is going to drop off initially. So unless you have it set to save it initially, it might only save it after the first 15 seconds, which means you lose that first starting voltage. So I've got that set. So everything's set up. I've got the name of the file, kind of Duracell Quantum. If we click start, we can see there the red line represents the voltage. The yellow one is the current. Voltage is obviously dropping off now. It's dropped from about its initial 1.6. It's at 1.4 and dropping. It'll obviously steady out as it is at the moment. And then the current, as you can see, is literally just below half an amp. So we're going to let this run. You can see, you can actually see real time the capacity in amp hour clocking up over there. But at the end of this, I'll be able to, pull this into the spreadsheet so we can get all the data, and we'll have a look at what end result we get from this battery. Right, and just to pull you into the actual load itself, just to see what's happening on the display, we can see obviously the voltage is steadily dropping off and the amp hours are clocking up. It's just showing that it's under remote control at the moment from the PC, and obviously there's a current that's being drawn from the battery itself. Right, so let's have a quick look. The test at 100 milliamp has completed. Those are the figures over there. You can see it's hit about 3.1 amp hour is what it says. Now that compares, it's a little bit less than what the Energizer achieved at that load. But just recall that that amp hour rating can be very misleading, because if the voltage stays higher, it's not accounting for that. So you ultimately, your energy can be far higher than what this is indicating. So the amp hour rating here can be very misleading. Let's just have a quick look at the profile on the Manuo software before I download it. Right, so here's the profile which I'm just about to download and pull into the actual spreadsheet so we can make some proper comparisons. And as you can see, a fairly nice curve. It held the voltage level reasonably well, obviously before the end. But the really surprising fact, or the one thing that these quantum batteries do seem to have up their sleeve, is that they're able to maintain the current right to the end, which is amazing. There's absolutely no drop-off, even once it gets to the kind of minimum of 0.1 volts, which I set. It manages to keep that, which even the Energizer couldn't do. But anyway, let's pull this into the spreadsheet and have a closer look.
Right, so the recording results in, and I've gone and graphed them in the Excel spreadsheet again. As you can see, it's got some nice, obviously, curves with the power, and or I should say watt hours and amp hours going up. As I said, I'll show you what amp hours can be misleading. The voltage, as you can see, has got this characteristic curve that we've got used to. But the really interesting thing is the current. It's just dead flat right to the end. Even as the kind of test ended at 0.1 volts, it was still doing half an amp. And if we compare that to the Energizer, you can see the Energizer, as we when we get to the summary page, you'll still see did perform better, a fair bit better, but it right at the end, still the current dropped off at the end. But what it did manage to do was maintain a flatter voltage line, which is obviously very good. Now, these are both the 500 milliamp tests. So if I click between them, look at the voltage line there on the Quantum versus the one on the Energizer. I'll just pull up the 100 milliamp. So if we go to the 100 milliamp test, here we go. This is for the Quantum, and that is for the Energizer. And again, you can see the kind of flatter voltage curve with the Energizer managing to maintain a very nice flat voltage, which is what you want ideally. But I must say, the Duracell Quantum, it's interesting to see how it just does maintain that current right through to the end. Let's just go and have a look at the summary page. If we have a look at the summary page, I've got them all in here. Just to note, I'm going to have this information on my forum. Some of the, there may well be mistakes, or people might want to kind of massage or shape the data they want to. As I said, I used this energy rate of change as kind of the point where I took the data. Now, on the later tests I'm doing, like with a Quantum, I'm taking a reading every 15 seconds. With the Energizer, I only took, because I was using a multimeter, I was taking a reading every 15 minutes. So the rate of change values there are different. So I had to do a bit more juggling. I had to go to four places on the rate of change for the Quantum to get to find out where it would actually cut off. So there are subtle differences you just have to realize if you are going through the data yourself. Anyway, here on the summary, as you can see, still the top one is the Energizer, obviously the 100 milliamp load. And the interesting thing to note here, and this is what I want to point out about amp hour, you can see that the second, when it was run at 500 milliamp, it seemed to produce more amp hour. So if you're purely going on amp hour, you'd say then, well, why obviously isn't this reading at the top? But obviously what happens here, because under less load, it had a flatter voltage curve, so ultimately the watt hours, which is the more important part, is what counts. So that's what you do need to go on, the watt hours. And then ultimately for this exercise, because we're doing energy density, is to go and have a look at the watt hour per kilogram. And so here you can see, obviously, number one, number two is the Energizer, and then number three and number four comes the Quantum. But as you can see, still a way behind. If you just go forget the weight side of it, because obviously that energizes a very light battery. The lithium battery is still producing a fair bit more watt hours in comparison at 100 milliamp hour, and comparing at the 500 milliamp, again, more watt hours. And that becomes more apparent once you start looking actually at the energy density, because the lithium is far lighter. So still, the energizer here is king. And here again, I presume the Duracell, that what they're trying to say, it's the world's longest lasting alkaline battery. But they don't really clearly say that. It's a bit misleading.
Right, and just as a last bit of fun, what I thought I'd do is I have these batteries, I've got them mixed up, and what I'm going to perform is the bounce test. Now, I've not done this before today, so I'll just demonstrate it. But basically, a battery which has been kind of fully discharged has got some bounce in it, whereas a fully charged battery doesn't bounce. So we'll just test that. I'm going to use this tube because at least it keeps them upright and it's easier to see. So if I put this one in, that would indicate that it's actually got charge in it. These two, I presume, are the ones that I've discharged. You can see the bounce. Next one, see the bounce. I'll get the one that's charged again. It just drops to the bottom. So an interesting little test that you can try at home. Right, and just to confirm, the one little added feature that the Quantums have, as some of the Duracells do have, is this kind of fuel gauge on the side. So again, if I push that with my fingers, you can see how the kind of fuel gauge goes up to 100%. And again, if I put it in the cylinder to bounce, solid.
Right, so I hope you found that interesting. As I said, it certainly seems like the kind of claims that Duracell are making about this being the world's number one longest lasting battery or cell should be rather like longest lasting alkaline rather than just say longest lasting battery and noting that it's an alkaline battery underneath. Certainly the Energizer lithium is by far has got the nice flat voltage line, which is what you're looking for, and then it just does last for a long time and it's lightweight. Certainly at the moment seems like the best one out there. If any of you do have any other battery chemistries or what have you that you think might be interesting to see their longevity, I have been doing some reading. There's some companies doing some interesting new lithium technologies which are kind of more robust. You can take them down to 100% depth of charge and still get like 1,000 cycles, or even take them up to 90% depth of charge and get over 2,000 cycles. So that's a technology which will be interesting. Also, both Frankie and the kind gent who sent me the nice torch have sent me lithium batteries to test. So I've got a host of both lithium and lithium iron phosphate batteries, which I'll be testing and putting the data into that spreadsheet. I'll put a link to the spreadsheet down below on my forum. As I said, it'll be a living spreadsheet which I update as and when I do more battery testing. As I said, if you see any glaring mistakes in there, then certainly point it out and I'll make corrections. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and please do, if you gain any value, please give us a thumbs up. I'll catch you soon for next video. Cheers.